I'm here to declare to you, my past is over. I'm in you. Things are made new. Surrendered my life to Christ. I'm moving, moving forward.
I want to thank God and give him all the praise, honor, and glory on this Palm Sunday. And we ought to give God the praise for Palm Sunday. It was the one time, it was the only time that Jesus was seen and viewed and treated and given the honor and the glory that he richly and truly deserved. It was the one time when folk understood who he was and they praised him and they called Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna to the highest. And it was at that moment that we were so close to getting it right. I wish I had somebody with me right now. But I thank God for Palm Sunday. Somebody just lift your hands and say, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
For this Palm Sunday.
Amen,
amen. Body of Christ, our theme, our new theme beginning this month of April is nothing ever happens until something is spoken. Nothing ever happens until something is spoken. Lord told me, he said, Maurice, I want you to stand before my people, especially as we approach the Power of Prayer Conference. And I want you to make sure that they know that talking to me and speaking to me over those things that are as though they are going to be is the most important thing that they can do right now. I want you to stand before my people and declare to them that there are blessings in speaking to me and speaking over those things that you feel bound by and speaking over those things you feel held back by. That I am giving you permission to understand that when you start to speak those things and declare those things in my name, that I'm there and that you are in my presence and I'm going to bless like never before. Let my people know at B4W that nothing ever happens until something is spoken. And so many people today look at me like I'm crazy when I tell them that your next blessing, your next breakthrough is not tied up in whether or not you get the raise or whether or not you get the job or whether or not you get the house, but your next breakthrough and your next blessing is right there on the tip of your tongue and it's just bursting to want to get out. So many people today that are going through it, so many people today that are involved in hurtful situations or have stress-filled lives right now or waking up daily feeling like you're being pounded by feelings of emptiness or feelings of loneliness or feelings of doubt and are quiet about those things and are silent about those issues in your life at a time when you should be crying out and screaming out and speaking out with a holy boldness because of who it is that you are in Christ Jesus. That, Lord, I know you can make a way, and I'm going to trust you because I'm going to speak over those things that I need you to do for me and do in my life right now. And so the big question becomes this morning, the big question becomes today as it relates to this particular passage of Scripture is, why is it that so many people that feel the sanctuary are so quiet? Why is it that so many people that read the Word of God and look at the Word of God and agree that His Word is good and that His Word is true are so silent? Why is it that so many people that are going through and are feeling like there's no way out aren't standing up in the house of God and declaring and speaking to the Father that sits high and looks low that I need you right now? Why is it that so many aren't speaking over those things that are holding you back? Why is it that so many aren't lifting up and praising the name of Jesus? Why is it that so many folks are sitting around and waiting for something to happen instead of taking the authority that God has given to you and speaking over that thing and calling it into being, calling it into life? Why is it that way? And the answer is because Satan, the enemy, has so many believers as well as non-believers impression or under the impression that your voice that God loves to hear. I think I just said something. And your cry that he still cares for. He has so many people believing that it does not count, that it does not matter. But I stop by to tell you today, or anybody that would listen, that you need to make a joyful noise unto the Lord, that you need to get your praise on, that you need to stand up and start to declare, even right now in the sanctuary, that Lord, I know you can do this thing for me. I know you can make a way for me. I know you can fix this thing. I know if I say it loud enough or long enough, but Lord, I'm not going to quit until you honor my request. I'm not going to go nowhere until you do something about my prayer. Or look at somebody and say, quit being quiet. Well, see, I'm here to tell you today, there is power in spoken prayer. There's power in spoken praise. There's power in spoken worship. There's power in spoken testimony.
Read that just dismiss that. What did he say?
Let us make.
Let who?
Let us.
Let us. Let us. Him and his son. Let us do what?
Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground.
See y'all the ground. See y'all just missing that. But somebody here, y'all just got that. You see, if you are made in the image of God, and you are made in the creation of God, that means you got God-like authority. And the same God that allowed to spoke everything into being has given you the authority to speak some things into being into your life. You got some power in what you say. You got some power in what you speak. You got some power because God has given you the authority because you are made in his image. You can tell the devil, get out of my house. You can tell trouble, you can't live here no more. You can tell a lack of joy. I got peace and I got a peace that the world didn't give and the world can't take it away. Why? Because God said. I need somebody to give me Psalm 20. Just verse 1, that's all I need is verse 1.
To you I come, O Lord my rock. Do not turn a deaf ear to me, for if you remain silent, I will be like those who have gone down to the pit.
David was going through. David had issues in his life. David had problems in his life. But David didn't ask for a financial blessing. David didn't ask for a miracle. He just asked that the silence be broken between him and God. All he wanted in the midst of his trouble was a spoken word.
The centurion replied, Lord, I do not deserve to have you come under my roof.
Yes.
But just say the word and my servant will be healed.
Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. Somebody here, that's you. You know you don't deserve his mercy and you don't deserve his grace. But you got enough faith and confidence and boldness that you're going to speak that stuff. And you don't need to tell him what to do. You just want him. If he says the word, he can speak change over your life this morning. Treated like he was the Messiah, the Son of the living God. the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the high priests, meaning those that were in charge of the synagogue, went out of their way time and time again to reduce or try and reduce the effectiveness of Jesus' ministry. And I can hear somebody saying here this morning, well, what does all that mean? How does that tie into our text today, Pastor? Well, what it means and how it relates to our text is that Jairus has a serious issue just because of what it is that I just said. What it means is that Jairus, who was a synagogue leader, he was like the assistant pastor of the church directly under the high priest. That means that this religious leader and his father with the sick child has a decision that he has to make based on the condition of his child. Well, I'm going to teach it anyway. He has to decide right now, even though his daughter is sick, even though the world says to ignore Jesus and don't speak a word to Jesus and don't call on Jesus, he has to make the decision, do I keep my social standing? Do I keep my name on the A-list in the community? Do I keep myself on the invite list? Do I keep my access parking pass for my camel and my donkey? Do I keep, oh, I gotta break that down, 2012 style. Do I keep the Now Network, or do I go with Sprint or Cricket? Oh, somebody felt me just deep. What is it that I need to do? Or do I break this silence, and do I speak this thing that's on the tip of my tongue and let everybody know, in spite of where they stand, that I believe in the redemption power, and I believe in the healing power, and I believe in the restoring power, and I believe in the resurrecting power of Jesus the Christ. And somebody here today, I gotta go there for a moment. That's your life right now. You got to make the choice today. Are you gonna sit here and remain silent? Are you gonna sit here and try and be cool? Are you gonna sit here and try and play it off? Or are you gonna speak that thing that's in your life right now that's got you to serve? Are you gonna speak over that obstacle? Are you gonna speak over that moment? Are you gonna speak over that hindrance? Are you gonna get up and say that thing that's bursting to get out? That I need you right now, Jesus, and I need a blessing right now.
Get here just as quick as you can. And when he said that, I jumped up and I
got to get back to his tent. Jairus, he's made a decision, and he gets to Jesus, and he petitions Jesus. He gets to the feet of Jesus, and he tells Jesus his story. And look at somebody say, you got to tell him your story. And I got a daughter, and she's sick, and I know you know who I am, and if you just come back with me and go back to my house with me and see my daughter, if you just touch my daughter, everything is going to be all right. And so you look at the word, Jesus doesn't even question this brother. He just starts to walk with him and starts to head to this man's house. And I like that about Jesus. You see, he doesn't try to convince you. You don't have to try to convince him. If you got faith, he's moving with you while you're moving. You might be in trouble, but he's walking right beside you. You might have a few haters, but he's got your back. You might have a turmoil, but he's working that thing out for you right there. And he's walking with him. And then as he begins to walk with him, he has an encounter with the woman with a 12-year bleeding condition. Y'all know how it goes. And while Jesus is ministering to this woman, while he's blessing this woman, Jairus gets a word from a messenger that tells him that your daughter has died. He gets a word from a messenger telling him that his daughter has died. And right there, Ms. Upshaw, Deacon Upshaw, I wanted to take the word and I wanted to put the focus on what happened with the daddy right there at that particular point in time, because I'm just keeping it real. You can't tell me that father, when he got the word that his daughter had died, wasn't looking at Jesus and saying, man, Jesus, I got here first, and if you had just come with me and you had just been with me and you had left what I said, and if you had been messing with the woman with the 12 years bleeding condition, if she's been bleeding for 12 years, what's 12 more minutes? What's 12 more hours? What's 12 more days? You should have left it and came with me at that point. That's why I wanted to take the word. But God said, no, that's not where my word is for the house today. My word is with the messenger. You see, there are times when we speak some things and folk try to get in our ear and try to mess with us about the thing that we have spoken. There are times when the devil tries to alter our faith over those things that we have spoken. And you need to know that that's why a lot of your spoken blessings aren't getting through, because you get sidetracked by the stuff that's coming out of somebody else's mouth.
Because you've done your
Look at somebody and say, you better say something. It's all right to praise him. Anybody here ever had the world try to put a bug in your ear about the fact that there's nothing that Jesus can do for you? And see, I'm trying to bless somebody this morning and got real quiet just then, so you might be bugged and you don't even know it. Look at yourself and say, I don't want no bugs on me. You might have some bugs. See, you might have a bug and you don't even know it. See, maybe your bug went something like this. Child, I don't know why you're still praying about that thing. Because if God was going to do that thing for you, he'd have been and done it by now. Or that might be your bug. Or maybe somebody put a bug in your ear and said, I don't know why you're listening to the preacher talking about one day you're going to get you a mate, a husband, or a wife. Don't you know if God was going to give you somebody, he would have gave you somebody by now? Or maybe your bug went like this, that something or somebody that you care about, your family member or your child, or maybe somebody's a dear friend, and you've been lifting them up, and in the midst of you lifting them up, somebody should have put a bug in your ear and said, don't you know that Negro was going to change? God would have changed him by now. Or maybe you had a bug and somebody told you that situation is dead. You lifting up and you trying to stand on the promises. Somebody told you you wasting your time with your faith. You wasting your time on that job. You trying to be positive for God and somebody putting a bug in your ear trying to let you know that you are wasting your time and that you shouldn't be out there like that. That you could better use yourself doing something else. That you missing something because you putting all your faith in the Lord. But I want you to look at what Jesus does right here in verse number 50. In the midst of healing this woman, in the midst of everything that's going on, Jesus is listening to the messenger. Oh, yes, he is. He's listening to the messenger as the messenger tells Jairus about his daughter. And in the midst of him listening to the messenger, Jesus then turns around and does something that gives confirmation that he hears that stuff. Because in the midst of what the man was trying to put in his ear, Jesus put something on his heart. Jesus told the man, he said, don't be afraid. Just believe, and your daughter is going to be all right. Oh, somebody up in here today needs to know that he hears that stuff. He hears people trying to tell you, don't do it. He hears folk trying to pull you out. He hears folk trying to hate on you. He hears folk trying to separate. But he's got a word for you in the midst of what the haters are saying. He's got a word for you in the midst of your trouble. And he's saying, don't be afraid. Just believe, and everything's going to be all right. Oh, do I have anybody up in here today that knows that
walking blessing. See, she's one thing to ask Jesus to come to your house. It's one thing to invite him in. It's another thing to give him control. I think I just said something. Jessica, the least out there, just said something. See, it's one thing that I need you because I need this to be done. I need you to heal my finances. I need you to heal my body. I need you to fix things at the crib. I need you to work this thing out. It's one thing to ask him to come. It's another thing to give him control once he shows up on the job. Well, I think I just said something right there. And if you look at this word, you will see that he asked Jesus to come with him. But if you check out verse number 51, when Jesus got to his house, the first thing that Jesus did was he started throwing folk out. Mom-in-law had to go. Daddy-in-law had to go. In-laws had to go. Relatives had to go. Friends had to go. The neighbor's dog and cat had to go. The high priest had to go. All kinds of folk had to go. Well, I think I'm just saying something right now. You see, some of the folk that you think you need, that you need around you, are the reason why you're in the condition that you're in right now. Because you've been listening to that stuff from generation to generation. Mama don't always know better. That might be what mama in the boat she in right now.
Say, Lord,
whoever you kick out,
it's going to
stay out.
serious about saying something, is move when he reaches for you. Lord, have mercy. You spoke in this thing, and you stood on this thing, and now he's got his hand out, and you in a bad spot, and now he's got his hand out, and you still in your difficult situation. Now he got his hand out, and you don't know what to do next. Now his hand is out, and you've been in trouble for so long. Now his hand is out, and you don't know which way to go, but that's the hand of Jesus that's reaching for you. And when he got to the house, and the people were laughing at him, he didn't even waste his time with the folks that was laughing at him. He just went on by him, and I think I just said something. There's some folks that think you done lost your mind because you done gave your life to the Lord. There's some folks that used to you and it was dependent upon you, still smoking weed and still buying cocaine and still doing heroin. There's some folks that was dependent upon you, still having that spirit of adultery, of fornication. There's some folks that was still dependent upon you to keep on being a person that didn't never have nothing, to sliding back and having a relapse again. There's some folks that's dependent upon you to still keep that stank attitude. There's some folks that's dependent upon you, they laughing at you, they telling you you ain't gonna make it, they telling you you ain't no good, they telling you that you don't count. Look at Jesus. He didn't try to explain to them both that I'm a different person, I'm a better person, I'm the Messiah, I'm the Son of the living God. Jesus walked right on by them fools and went to where it was that he was going. And that's what you gotta start doing with your life. You gotta walk right on by the folk that's doubting you. You gotta walk right by the folk that's telling you what you ain't gonna have. You gotta walk right by the folk that's telling you what you'll never be. You gotta keep headed to your destination. Now,
so just walk right on by your haters and keep on moving towards a destination.
I'm moving ahead. I'm here to declare to you, my past is over. I'm in you. Things are made new. Surrendered my life to Christ. I'm moving, moving forward. What a moment you have brought me to, such a freedom.